Hi guys! Today I'm going to talk about fingerboards. Having a fingerboard working really well for you is super important. The neck and fingerboard together are the main support of your left hand. And so there are three things that are crucial about a fingerboard. The first one is like the measurements of width and thickness of the fingerboard that they're right, so the width at the top here and at the bottom. The second one is the curvature, that it has the right curve to work in properly with the bridge. And the third one is that it's concave from one end to the other. Let me explain. Firstly, the actual width down the bottom here and up the top, and the thickness. So they're hugely important for how the fingerboard feels under your fingers. So if your fingerboard is really thick from here to there, you might, you know, the neck might just feel a bit on the thick side. And then also the width, you want to have a little bit of space next to your hand. I've got really broad hands, and so for me, I need a bit of extra width on the side. Otherwise, when I'm playing double stops, the side of my hand here will actually touch the E string and take away from the clarity. So getting that width exactly right is super important. Now the string width on the nut up here and the bridge down here, that's kind of a given. But the width of the fingerboard here and here, that's hugely important. It also depends a little bit on how wide the neck is. So if everything's correct, that's a lot better. So as you can see, the width and the thickness of the fingerboard is really important. The next thing is the curvature. So the curvature is slightly more. I'll show you my template for the violin curvature. So this is the template for my violin curvature, and this is the template for my bridge curvature, this one here. And you can see that the fingerboard is slightly more curved than the bridge. So this has been worked out to perfectly work for when you're doing double stops and you need to move around the fingerboard fast. Okay, here's one of my violins that hasn't had the fingerboard planed yet. So having the fingerboard planed is hugely important, like planed correctly. And that way you will get this curvature correct. And this is actually very close. If you look, you can see a little bit of a gap, but it is actually quite close to the curvature we're looking for. So that curvature is really important. So that curvature is just that little bit more than the curvature of the bridge. And obviously on a viola, cello, and double bass, the curvatures are all slightly different. But the idea is the same on each instrument. So the curvature helps with playing double stops and working in with the bridge. Now the final thing that not a lot of people know about is that the fingerboard is actually concave. When you look at a fingerboard like this, from this end to this end is actually slightly hollow. And that allows the string to vibrate more in the middle. So if the fingerboard was totally flat, it would actually just do a little faint buzzing noise as you're playing the string. And that would just take away from the clarity of the sound. And not a lot of people know this. So I'm going to put a ruler across this fingerboard so you can see it. Now, can you see there's actually a gap? So the ruler is touching at the ends of the fingerboard here, but not in the middle because it has a slight dip. So on the violin, the dip is supposed to be 0.7 of a millimeter. So if you look at the ruler here, 1 millimeter, yep, that's right, that little, it's even less. And that's 0.7 of a millimeter is on the G, and 0.5 of a millimeter on the E string. So obviously the G vibrates a lot more than the E string does. Again, on a viola and cello, this is different. So on a cello, it's 1.5 millimeters from end to end for the C. And on a double bass, it's actually 2.5 millimeters. So you can kind of see there's 2.5 millimeters. So it's quite a big dip. So quite often people come into me and their instrument is just, it has a slight buzz to it. And sometimes it's actually just because the fingerboard isn't concave. But there's also another thing that happens. Believe it or not, with a lot of playing, you will actually wear grooves into the fingerboard. Firstly with your fingers, but then also the strings buzzing along can also wear grooves.
Here is a set of stairs, and if I was exercising and walking up and down those stairs lots every day, I guess after a very long time I'd start wearing grooves into the stairs like this. That's kind of the same with your violin fingerboard. So when you're moving your fingers across the fingerboard on the violin, you end up wearing grooves into it.
So this is a violin that was used by a professional musician for quite a few years, and she just didn't have the time to have the fingerboard planed as regularly as she should. So take a look at this. This is kind of interesting. So you can actually see the wear and tear on the fingerboard. So firstly, you can see just here, you can see the grooves that the strings have caused, but then there's other grooves. So there's light dints all the way across here. That's, you know, on the first finger, second finger, and all the way up. It's usually mostly down the bottom because most of the really hard work of when you're playing is done in the first position, and your finger strength is the strongest down there. But it's quite amazing. So every, you know, between half a year and a few years, you may actually need to have your fingerboard planed to make sure that it, you know, there aren't grooves like that worn into the fingerboard. So it's just part of instrument maintenance. But, you know, when you get your annual service, that's something I always check. So I'm going to show you what I actually do to plane the fingerboard and get it right. So both of these fingerboards need planing. So this is actually a new instrument that my makers have made, and this is the old instrument, and I actually have to plane both fingerboards to get the right shape, and I'll show you how I do that. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to need to do is to protect the instrument. That's really important. So I've got this leather guard that I put on here to protect the instrument. And next, I'm going to have to take off the nut. So the nut is up here, and I'm going to just very carefully split it off. This one wasn't very firmly attached, so it came off super easy, and that's actually a good thing. It doesn't need to be glued on very strongly because the strings hold it on. Sometimes people glue the nut on extremely strongly. It makes it so hard for the violin makers that want to do maintenance. Okay. So next I get my plane. I love this Lee Nielsen plane, it's really good. And just start planing. I'll be checking to make sure that the curvature is right. Now the ebony on this particular fingerboard is quite soft, and you can see it has a lot of lighter color in here, so it probably wears a lot quicker than some other fingerboards. Just going to check the curvature. It's actually a little bit too round, so I'll have to take off more in the middle. I've finished planing the fingerboard. Now it's time to use the scraper, and after that it's going to be time for sanding. So this is my scraper, and I'm going to use that to smooth out the fingerboard a little bit. Okay, that's better. I'm just gonna, just around the top, there's always a little bit of a problem, so. Okay, time to get into the sanding. I start off with quite a coarse grade of sandpaper, and then I take it down to finer and finer sandpapers. So this is my sanding block, and it actually has the correct curvature of the fingerboard. So that makes life a lot easier to get everything 100% right. Up to the fine sandpaper. This is where things get to look beautiful. That's really pretty, actually. Now it's just time to clean everything. So yeah, that's looking really good now, and that's going to be much easier to play. So as you can see, it is super important that your fingerboard has the right curvature, the right thickness and width, and that it's slightly hollow. And when those things are perfect and your string height is right, it's just so much easier to play double stops and play cleanly. And having a good fingerboard doesn't mean that you don't have to practice. Remember, when you practice lots, you can reach your goals as a string player. If you like my videos, hit subscribe and hit the little bell next to it so that you find out every time I post another video. Talk to you soon.